So, what do you think?
The supreme personality of Godhead is gorgeous. I noticed immediately coming in the door.
Afterwards, I will show you the rest.
The large part was not well sized.
Correct.
Yeah,
I agree. This is much nicer.
And then like this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Everybody is back, or I am back. What news? So you're not here for 1 month course?
Not the whole thing, no.
When do you go? When do you come back?
I leave February 17th and come back March 2nd.
Oh, okay, that's not too bad. March 2nd, you.
Yeah, I'll still get a couple weeks.
Yeah, you will. Now, before we even go, what is today? Mundaka Upanishad. I have a personal appeal to all of you, really, and which will be iterated again tomorrow. Tomorrow is class again?
Tomorrow
yes,
class.
Yes.
Not this class.
Yeah, another class. So, as much airtime this appeal has, the better it is. You know, I made the same appeal in 2013 when we had the previous 1 month course. And what is this appeal? In the sense that, you know, two things. One is that it is, you know, this month there will be a lot of classes. I think some of you have already received the schedule. So there will be classes coming out of the years. So many classes are there. And when you attend those classes, it is benefiting you, of course, but it is also benefiting the other 150 plus people that have signed up. Because you know, it makes it more interesting if there are people in front, because otherwise it feels like one is, you know, talking to oneself, which one can do. Anything is possible with Vedanta. And you know, when there was no other option, this is what, you know, I was doing, sitting in a little kutia in Georgia. this is how it all started. Correct? And Eugene was with me right from the start, really. And so I'm counting on all of you to talk. This is what Janani suggested, that everybody can talk amongst oneself, amongst each other, and find out who can attend what, so that there is some quorum. We already have decorum. We don't need decorum. Everybody has decorum, but we need quorum, a quorum of live people, especially things like chanting, you know. Yeah. So, and please oblige. And when you do that, you will have the blessings of all the other 150 plus people from 17 countries who have signed up. Because it's going to be a much nicer experience for them, and because there's going to be dialogue, there's going to be this. Otherwise, the online thing has really no meaning, you know. We just say, okay, the technology is there, and somebody, you know, some Mahatmas sponsor all these wonderful and expensive platforms for us to broadcast, and we do that. But really speaking, this is a one-to-one endeavor. This is a one-on-one thing. That's why Sahana Vavatu mantra is in dual. Yeah. It's dual. So the online part of the course is meant for people not here. Yeah. So if you are also here and you take it online, you know, it is I mean, it's okay if that's what you got to do, but I would not recommend it. So, and I know that it's, you know, it's like on the weekends, it's like 7 hours of teaching. So everybody can't be here for everything. And, you know, one can do two things. So it can be like the Milky Lake story. You know the Milky Lake story? No? Okay, so there was a quirky king in ancient India who was walking with his minister on a full moon night. He was enjoying the scenery, and he saw the lake and the moon reflected on the lake, and he had a very kind of a quirky idea, very bad for fish and yeah, water, aquatic life. And his idea was, oh, how nice it would be if the ocean was, not the ocean, the lake was totally milky. And then the milky moon reflected on the milky lake, and then this night would add to it. Why not? Let's do that. And the minister said, how, Maharaj? How can you do that? And he said, it's simple. It's not very expensive. You always think of money. You just tell each citizen, tell the town crier to go to each citizen of the people in the living in the area, in the kingdom, to bring one glass of milk and put it every day. And then by the next full moon, it will all be milky. This is not rocket science. Of course, he wouldn't have said that because the rocket science was not there. This is not something difficult. And the minister was skeptical, but nonetheless he was fond of his head. He wanted to keep it for a long time so that his family and all can benefit, correct? And so what did he do? He duly sent out the town crier, who said, you know, if you don't do this, you'll be punished, and you have to put one glass of milk every day in the lake. You know? And then what? And then the king couldn't wait till the next full moon. He just couldn't even sleep the night before. He was so excited about seeing the milky moon on the milky lake on this wonderful, you know, night. And then duly both of them trotted off to walk, the minister and the king, hand in hand to see this wonderful sight. Disappointment of disappointment, there was nothing there. Just the black waters greeted them, and of course the full moon was there. The king was incensed, livid, and he said, what happened? I told everybody. He says, summon all the people right now. But Maharaj, it's 10 o'clock at night. I don't care. Summon everybody right now. And so everybody stood around the lake, the hapless and the scared citizens shaking in their shoes. And then, you know, the king said, you have defied the order. What happened over here? How come it's not milky? And if you don't tell the truth, off with your head. And then they confessed. Each one said, I thought the other one was going to do it. So my little one glass was not going to make a difference. So this story is an upalakshana. Yeah. The glass of milk is your attendance in class. So if, you know, milk is always, you know, a kind of a very sattvic liquid. And so milk is called kshira. You know, kshira is very, you know, is like akshara. In a sense, it's all complete and it's all pure. And so, your being here, you can't discount yourself. And the same story is illustrated in the 10th man, and the same story is also illustrated in this one. The same point is talked about. And so here in Eugene, you know, plan to attend a lot of classes in the next month. And so talk to each other, talk amongst yourself, and have some, you know, just like you have designated drivers, you have so you have designated attendees, correct? So the rest of the people can have a wonderful free experience, you know. Yeah, we can get intoxicated in the Vedas because we have designated drivers, no problem. So that is how it is. So that is my personal appeal. I was going to write it as an email, but I think it's much more fun in person.
So if I'm understanding, our sitting here is pouring milk abhisheka upon the divine.
Yes, absolutely. It is a, yeah. It is milk abhisheka here, it is milk abhisheka everywhere, and also that's why Lord Dakshinamurti is a very important form of Ishtadevata, because the Lord is complete without you. Incomplete, sorry, without you. That's why it's called Ashtamurti, the eight aspected, you know, that which has no aspects, of course, but from the standpoint of the Lord, eight aspects. So the five elements, sun and the moon, the two celestials who impact the earth. And what is the eighth one? You. Oh, but I thought I was the 10th man, now I'm the 8th man. I think we should stop here itself. So you know, this 8th, you know, that's what it is. And why do you, you know, complete the Lord? Because you are the Lord. And similarly, you complete this knowledge, because the knowledge is incomplete without students. But what about the other 150 there? Because, you know, you can't see them. They are there, yes. You have to take it upon pramana. And pratyaksha pramana is not there. You have to infer that they are there because the names are there. But here you are all really here. And so what happens is that there is a synergy, and there is a certain kind of a, what's the word for it? There's a certain kind of a, that interaction in that sacred, you know, atmosphere of the teaching, the interaction between the teacher and the student, the teacher and the taught, you know, gives rise to wonderful things. You know, may we accomplish great things. Sahana Vavatu Mantra, third line says, you know, Sahaviryam Karavavahai. So we accomplish great things together, you know, because the teacher by oneself doesn't really need to or have the pressure to teach. And the student by themselves are just students or seekers. But the two here is a very dynamic duo, you know, for the attainment of non-duality. Very nice irony here. For understanding and internalizing this non-duality, this duo is very important. And so in that synergy, there is a certain thing that happens which is actually very esoteric, which cannot be talked about, which is unable, because sukshma, very subtle. So on the subtle level, there are great transformations that take place, and we offer this transformation that is happening in this room and in here as a yajna for the rest of the people who attend the course. That is our offering. And, you know, so that is great punya also. That's wonderful. And, you know, and that is how it is. And a teacher, you know, becomes a better teacher. The teacher is already comes with a certain wonderful ammunition derived from their teacher. The ammunition in the form of the blessings. But then that already carries the teacher through because of the blessings and the anugraha, the grace of his or her teacher. But then that grace carries one, and along with that grace, what makes that teacher a better teacher, you know, in the sense of more responding to the problems and the issues and the difficulties in comprehension at hand are the students, really. You know, because of you, I have learned to teach in a way that is understood better, you know. So that is how it is. So don't discount your presence. Every single person attending is extremely important. Okay? Yeah. ॐ भद्रं कर्णेभिः शृणुयाम देवाः भद्रं पश्येमाक्षभैर्यजत्राः स्थिरैरङ्गैस्तुष्टवागंसस्तनोभिः व्यश्येम देवहितं यदायुः स्वस्ति न इन्द्रो वृद्धश्रवाः स्वस्ति नः पूषा विश्ववेदाः स्वस्ति नस्तार्क्ष्यो अरिष्टनेमिः स्वस्ति नो बृहस्पतिर्दधातु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ सहनावतु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः टू टू थ्री धनुर्गृहीत्वोपनिषदं महास्त्रम् शरं ह्युपासानिशितं सन्धयीत शरं ह्युपासानिशितं सन्धयीत आयम्य तद्भावगतेन चेतसा आयम्य तद्भावगतेन चेतसा लक्ष्यं तदेवाक्षरं सोम्यविद्धि लक्ष्यं तदेवाक्षरं सोम्यविद्धि वन् मोर् टैम् धनुर्गृहीत्वोपनिषदं महास्त्रम् धनुर्गृहीत्वोपनिषदं महास्त्रम् शरं ह्युपासानिशितं सन्धयीत शरं ह्युपासानिशितं सन्धयीत आयम्य तद्भावगतेन चेतसा आयम्य तद्भावगतेन चेतसा लक्ष्यं तदेवाक्षरं सोम्यविद्धि लक्ष्यं तदेवाक्षरं सोम्यविद्धि
साउंड इज नॉट क्लियर वंडर व्हाई लेट्स सी व्हाट हैपेंड Adjust microphone volume, that's okay. What about the other one? Speaker volume, that's also okay. Sound is okay? All right. Wonderful. Somebody said louder, please. Wonderful. Let's see if this, I can make it a little louder here. I don't know. Is this on? Is everything on?
It's on.
Okay. All right, it's good now. So, in the last mantra,
the directive was given that the student, the pleasing student here, you know, should know. What should the student know? That this etad satyam etad amritam tad vedhavyam, not veditavyam. Veditavyam means to be known, but vedhavyam should be struck at. It's a pun. So veditavyam and vedhavyam, you know, and vidhi, again, all of it, you should strike at it, meaning you should know it completely. What should you know? That precisely what is to be known here is Brahman. That, of course, is a no-brainer, correct? Yeah. K-N-O-W, no-brainer. And this is a no-brainer, that Brahman is that which is to be known. You know, Veditavyam Kim, Brahma. What is to be known? Brahman. But then the question is, Kim Tad Brahma? What is this Brahman? And it has to be known as you, not as other than me. Because as other than me, it becomes yet one more object in the universe to be experienced. And then all experiences being infinitely finite, then Brahman also, poor Brahman, becomes finite. Correct? Yeah. So it has to be known how? It has to be known as I. What I? Not the complaining, querulent, querulous I, but the I that is free of all upadhis, all restrictive, limiting upadhis. Upadhis means things that qualify, so-called, you know, that qualify the I, the body, the mind, etc., the panchakoshas, all these things. So the I has to be known free of the upadhi, and you can't say, let me jump out of the upadhi in order to know the I. Not an option. And so the I has to be known as free of the upadhi while living in the upadhi as this Brahman. And what is this Brahman? Because I is Brahman, okay, but what is this Brahman? Jagat Karanam, that which is the cause of the universe. So you see, there are three ways in which the I has to be understood, or you can say, in which Brahman has to be understood. Brahman has to be understood as Atma, because I am Atma, Brahma, Mandukya Upanishad, Mahavakya. This Atma is indeed Brahman, nothing else is there. So Brahman has to be understood as Atman, nothing other than oneself. But what is this Brahman? So then there are two definitions given for understanding Brahman. One is Jagat plus, one is Jagat minus. Yeah. So Jagat plus becomes what? Ishvara. So the status that is superimposed upon that which is free of upadhis, free of all limitations, free of anything, free of attributes, free of dharmas, free of, you know, all kinds of qualifications, qualities, etc. On that is deliberately superimposed, and as though role, creator, Ishvara, you know. So that creatorhood is a role that is superimposed upon Brahman. This is one way of knowing Brahman, and a very important way, because we live in a manifest universe, and this body, mind, sense, complex becomes a subject, becomes subject to the laws of the creator. And so the jiva grieves. Grivati, yeah. Shochati, grieves how? Oh, I'm not free. I'm sick. This is a pranic identification. I have fever. Sukshma, you know, fever is Hiranyagarbha. So you need some sukshma methods of thermometer and everything. And it's getting very, very subtle. You know, before you had to, you know, imagine a crying infant and you had to put the thermometer here, you know, under the armpit and hold the infant, this cranky little thing, colicky, cranky little thing, you have to hold it still for 1.5 minutes in order to read the temperature. And meanwhile, the infant is bawling and saying, I'm not okay, this, I'm, you no need to do this. You know, I already know I'm not okay. And I'm going to let you know also. And then, of course, later on, for, you know, when you are old enough not to chew, then you have the under the tongue one, correct? That also is not so subtle. And now, recently I saw in one doctor's office, like a magic wand. You don't even know what happened, you know. Oh, then, okay, I missed one step. Then there was this ear thing. When you stuck something in the ear, not for 90 minutes, perhaps only for 30, not for 90 seconds, 30 seconds, and click, click, okay, yes, you have fever. I already knew that. Yeah, but we didn't know that and we don't believe you. We have Shraddha only in our instruments, not in you. And now it's become even more subtler. You can be in the next state and they'll go fsh, fsh, and then say, your temperature is 102. I think you need to come into the doctor's office. So it's so subtle, correct? Yeah, so now the instruments are also getting subtle. So like this, yeah, you know, I am sick. In the word, in the phrase, in the sentence, I am sick. That means what? Sickness is equal to what? Me. Yeah, that's what the whole thing is. That identification is what is being talked about here, this loosening this identification. Because the sickness itself becomes me. And what is this sickness because of? Why do I have a fever? You know, this is of course taking me on a different tangent, but I'll not go there. I'll tell you that later. Okay, I'll tell you right now. So, it won't stop. So, you know, in the olden days, when the missionaries came to colonize and, you know, and when they were trying to convert the people in India, they would say things like this, Annamal has a fever. Oh, she has a fever? Oh, poor thing. Poor Annamal. Why does she have a fever? Keep listening. This is the pastor, you know, preacher, the priest. Annamal has a fever. Neither her younger sister nor her older brother, meaning they don't have fever. Only Annamal has a fever. Why? Because the other two have been converted. Yeah, Annamal is holding out. Therefore, the wrath of God, she's got a fever. As though Christians don't get fever, you know, really. So this is, you know, this is kind of a logic which was, you know, deployed for converting the people. So when, you know, in this statement, I have, or I am sick, there is an identification with the sickness. What is the cause of sickness? The cause of sickness is not, this is where, why that story came into mind. The cause of sickness is not because you are not getting converted to Christianity. That's not the cause of sickness. What is the cause of sickness? Your own karma, correct? Or there is a bug, you know? Or somebody sneezed right in your face, you know, and then those bugs said, a new home, wonderful, you know, let's migrate. It's time to get our visas and immigrate. This person looks very kind and this person looks like a wonderful host, will treat us nicely, has been healthy, let us, you know, go. So whatever the reason, and it all boils down to karma anyway. So the karma is also a manifestation of Ishvara in the form of a law, right? Yeah. So from the standpoint of being identified with the body-mind-sense complex, I feel completely under the rubric, under the framework and oppressed by the laws. Correct? Yeah. So here is the lawgiver and here is the law receiver. The law receiver feels completely victimized. The giver has the agency, the receiver is the bhokta. Bhokta atra jivaha. This jiva is the bhokta. So this karta bhokta connection is there. Sometimes the jiva thinks I am the karta, but then only to be disappointed.
finally comes back to bhokta. Bhokta. And what is this bhoga? The bhoga is not a sweet bhoga. It's a bitter bhoga. It's like having bitter gourd karela for dinner, karela for lunch, karela for breakfast every day. Some people do that. You know, they buy a juicer and squeeze karela juice and have it first thing in the morning. Don't ask how. Ask them. Don't ask me. Okay? And then they have just the vegetable, you know, sautéed without anything else for lunch. And then they have it in another form for dinner. Imagine doing that day in and day out. You know, even the nicest person will get ornery, you know. So, but this is what is happening. On the level of karma phala, this is what it appears, that there is karela, karela, karela in my basket every day. In my basket of bhoga, there is karela only. And this is the perception, this is not a reality. This perception has to be righted. Because why? Because that you, the I that I think, who is afflicted by all the laws, is not the ultimate you. It is only a vyavaharika you. It's only an empirical, transactional you, the I, that is as though afflicted, and that as though has to be understood by letting go of the identification with the various upadhis, which the upadhis form part of the jagat. Jagat is nothing but upadhis. Name and form, name and form, name and form, word and meaning, word and meaning, word and meaning. So these endless upadhis are as though containers for this Brahman, which is free of all upadhis. Just like our space, where? In the pot. The pot space. The pot is an as though container for space, which was free, which is still free, which will be free if the pot breaks. Which was always free. So the I, which is always free, is as though encased by this body-mind-sense complex, which is ultimately inconsequential. But then it seems consequential because there is a tadatmya, an identification, and a helpless identification with the body, where anything that happens, you know, all one needs is a little bit of backache to turn one away, turn one's back away from Brahman. Finished, you know. When the going is good, you can just pontificate on oneness. Oh, this is just one. You don't know it too bad. You know, I know it. It's all just one. I heard this recently. There's no problems. Nothing is, you know, everything is okay, this person said. And then what? Where is my wallet? What happened? How dare they take my wallet? Who took? Where is it? How dare they do this? This is in 1 second the transformation happened, you know. Dr. Vedantin to Mr. Hyde. You know, the 1 second the transformation happened. Why? Because this is, you know, this is what it is. You know, Vedanta in action, someone said. Vedanta in action is that assimilation on the level of the day-to-day living. And the total and complete eschewal of these identifications. This is what it is. Easier said than done, correct? So this is with, you know, Brahman as Ishvara is not someone that you can look at in the face. And, you know, without my own superimpositions, pratibhasikam coming in the way. Who are you? Why did you do this to me? How dare you do this to me? How can you do this to me? All these things. So obviously some homework is needed to know this Brahman, correct? As Ishvara. And then what about Brahman as you, that is free of even jiva-ness or Ishvara-hood, Ishvara-ness, jiva-hood, same thing. How to understand that which is one as everything? That also is not easy. It's harder to conceptualize. It's in fact easier to relate to Ishvara. Much easier. Much harder to conceptualize this. And so,
even though this has been talked about, Brahman as Ishvara we saw, as the one from which everything has come, the one by which everything is sustained, the one unto which everything resolves seamlessly. And also that was talked about. And then this is what is called Tatastha Lakshana, the definition of Brahman in relationship to the Jagat, as the cause of the Jagat. And then we had also the Swarupa definition, the Swarupa Lakshana, which is what? You know, Tad Adrekshyam Agrahyam Avarnam Agotram Apanipadam. In this, you know, Swarupa Lakshana, you know, Satchidananda or Satyam Jnanam Anantam in Taittiriya. But here we have to look at what is said here. Tadetad yad adrekshyam, that which is not an object of sight, agrahyam, keep your paws off, it is not going to, you cannot grasp it. Avarnam, no color. What color is Brahman? Blue light, yellow light, no color, no form. Avarnam, agotram, which parampara does Brahman come from? Arshavidya? No lineage, no antecedents, no precedents, nothing. It just is, simply is. And that is I. That's why the first letter of is what? I. Very simple. And, you know, agotram, apanipadam, limbless. Can I shake hands? No, it has no hands, no legs. Will it run away? No, it just is. And that is the one, Shubhram, free of Punya Papa. And, you know, Nityam, all these things. First is it's negating all the Upadhis, and then it is talking about what it really is. And so, these are the two ways I have to understand Brahman. And I have to see myself as that. Ayyo, how to proceed? Because the teaching is complete. There's nothing more to teach. Yet the Upanishad doggedly continues. Why? Because, you know, she is like 1,000 functional, loving mothers. She perseveres, but in a very loving way. She does not buy into the hopelessness of the student who says, this is very nice, I enjoyed reading it, okay, next, you know, finished with the book. This is a nice concept. Somebody told me, Vedanta is a wonderful concept, but then you have to pay your bills. What is the logic? This is what happens when Satyam and Mithya go for a walk together. Satyam reality, Mithya shadow. So you go for your walk with the shadow and always are worried. Oh, the shadow tripped over the stone. I think I have to take it to emergency care. Oh, the shadow fell into the water. It's going to catch pneumonia. Oh, the shadow did this. Oh, the shadow did that. Preoccupied with the shadow. You know. So Satyam and Mithya cannot go hand in hand for a walk. There is no connection between the two. They don't even see each other. From the standpoint of the other one doesn't exist. From the standpoint of the Satyam, Mithya doesn't exist. There is no existence. All there is Satyam. Satyam says, what Mithya? What shadow? Where are you? Who are you? There's nothing other than me. It's like the ego of a two-year-old, you know, who considers, I'm Ishvara, I can do anything. Oh, you have to share. What? What's that? It's all for me. And then, you know, but from the standpoint of Mithya, you know, what? Oh, without Satyam, I don't exist. I'm a dependent reality. I have to latch on to Satyam. That is all it is. So really speaking, this is not a reality. The non-reality is affirmed as a reality because of one's own, you know, ignorance. And so, therefore, Satyam and Mithya cannot go for a walk. No. Although we have a nice poem, Owl and the Pussycat. Yeah, very interesting. One predator, one prey. If it's a big cat, pun intended, the owl becomes breakfast. Yeah. If it's a small cat, you know, cat becomes breakfast. So predator and prey. Owl and the pussycat went to sea in a little pea green boat. They took some honey and some money, both of them. They wrapped in a 5-pound note. And they get married also. Yeah, and they don't have a ring, and a helpful pig comes and says, take the ring at the end of my nose and finish the ceremony. That can happen, but you know, and then you know the internet is exploding with all kinds of unlikely friendships, and people keep sending me these things, you know. Yeah, these unlikely animal friendships, you know, cat and mouse cuddled together, dog and cat, you know, just loving one another, goat and crow, you know, all these things they send. And but here all that is very nice, and you can say, ah, how sweet, but that's nice pastime, but Brahman and Mithya, Satyam and Mithya, no unlikely friendship. Why? Because, you know, the abhava of the other, because the other one is really not there. Just like you cannot make friends with your shadow. Oh, but in the last retreat, talking about the unconscious, you said we have to make friends with the shadow. That is in a different context. That is as a preparation. Yeah. You make friends with it, you integrate it in this, in the light of this teaching. That is what we were talking about then. That was Zen, this is Tao, you know. So this is what the whole thing is. And so therefore what? So therefore we need an upaya. What is upaya? A intense and a quick fix remedy. Why? Because the desire to know has not gone. The head is still on fire. And then what? I'm left with this, these gems, this Brahman, which is everything, and me, which is also this same as this Brahman, but this me, you know. I'm not, how, so many me's, so little time, you know, and before one tears one's hair out in frustration. The upaya, the remedy is given. The remedy is always a practice. The remedy is given, Adi Shankara would say, he is going to say that later when we see in the Bhashya, for a non-adhikari. Oh, that means I'm not an adhikari. You know that face? What is that? Sad face. Well, in Adi Shankara's time, the one that was counted was an Uttama Adhikari. Alone was an Adhikari. Adhikari means a person qualified to learn. So if Adhikari is there, and the means of knowledge is there, and the Guru is there, then what happens? Knowledge has to take place. And here what is happening here means Iha. Iha means what? Not just here in this room, but here in this continent, here in this Jagat. You know, big here. Here what is happening, the knowledge is kind of understood, yet to be assimilated. So you cannot say, I don't know, because one has been studying. You can say, I am in the process of knowing. How long is this process? If you ask Lord Krishna, in the Bhagavad Gita, he says, Achirena gacchati. Not too long. But that length, so to speak, is immaterial. And also, it depends on the adhikaritvam. So, if the adhikaritvam is needing to be developed, then we need upaya. So, what does the upaya do? The remedy does not come in the way of the knowledge. I mean, the remedy does not give the knowledge, neither does it stop you from knowing. It helps to settle the mind. Chitta naishchalyam. And then what? It helps to purify the mind from all the litany of ragadveshas that are abusing the mind. Go after me. Me. Yeah. So, chitta shuddhi and chitta naishchalyam are the prasada of upaya called meditation. And the teaching is now, in Kali Yuga we use a lot of words, but in the olden days, if you went and asked a teacher for the knowledge, the teacher would just say in a few sentences, this is Brahman, you are Brahman, Brahman is Jagat Karanam, and this Jagat Karanam is just a superimposition even on that Brahman, which is free of all attributes, and that is you. And then you say, well, this is what I have understood, am I right? And the teacher will not say you are right, teacher will not say you are wrong, especially if you are wrong. The teacher will say, you need to go meditate. Or you, if you are unable to meditate, then what? Go to the cow shed. We saw that. We saw how long Indra spent in the cow shed during the Thanksgiving retreat. How many years was it? 101 years. Yeah. He turned into a cow, really, by the time. May as well have turned into a cow. But not possible, but possible Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati. Yeah. So he spent so long, he knew every little spot on every little cow. He was counting the teeth of every cow, all the molars, incisors, everything he knew. And, you know, that much time was needed for the king of heaven, somebody as exalted, Punya Sharira, as exalted as that, needed this much time to assimilate, to understand the teaching. We are in very good company. No problem. Yeah. So this upaya is to accelerate the understanding, not directly, but it is an indirect means for the knowledge. How is it an indirect means? It's an indirect means because it helps to gain the mind, which is important in gaining this clarity. What do you mean gain the mind? Because the mind is given away, frittered away in all kinds of nonsense, nonsensical pursuits, nonsensical preoccupation, nonsensical ideas, nonsensical, you know, desires. That is where the mind is held hostage. So, you know, there is an expression in English, giving somebody the peace of mind, correct? Yeah. Here the mind, the pieces of mind are already given away. That's why one has no peace of mind. P-E-A-C-E. Because the mind is in pieces, it's all just given away. There is no focus, there is no alertness, there is no clarity, because even when one is listening, one is thinking, one is listening, one is not really listening. So the listening itself becomes a sadhana, you know, only when the mind is available. And here, this upaya is to make the mind more available. And this is a powerful meditation on the syllable Om. It is called Pranava Upasana. Pranava is another word for Om. Prakarshena Navaha. That which is always new. When you say Om, 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 the tiredness goes away. You really feel refreshed. And then you say it some more. Om, Om, Om. Then you feel even more refreshed. And you have the clarity why this refreshment is happening, because Om is the biggest dropper. It makes the mind drop whatever it's clinging on to. Om, 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 Dhadam, that was a big one. Yeah, that's why it made a noise. Om, crash, you know. Huge. Om, ha. You know, you feel light, you feel relieved, you feel like you're a helium balloon. Yeah. Before, one was a lead balloon. And the Om was just a reminder that all the things that I'm clutching, that the mind is clutching, and the mind has taken on the shape and the form of those very things of preoccupations, those very afflictions,
that is not real, that is not true, that is not necessary, I can let go. Om is a permission to let go. Very beautiful. So when I say Om, so permission to let go. But then, I give myself the permission, Om, finished. And you know, Pujya Swamiji, when somebody was going on and on about something and he would try to explain, he would say, this is not really the time to do this. And they would keep on going and he would say, Om. Still they would keep on going, Om, in his booming voice, and they would immediately stop. Even the person who had no Shraddha, did not know Swamiji, so came from somewhere suddenly, he would say, Om. Om is the permission to let go. Om means all that is here is I now am. There's nothing else. Om. You know, Om is equal to the bell in Buddhist meditation. You know? What happens there? They will have a, you know, they'll be sitting in meditation, you know, on a seat, on a cushion. Then there is that bell with a little striker, wooden striker, and then this brass bell, very beautiful, sometimes resonates to different swaras. And that has its own little cushion, that's also in meditation. And then the teacher or anybody who is leading the meditation will strike at this bell periodically. And they even when not sitting in this meditation, they have this habit of striking at the bell because it's an invitation, an order to come back to oneself. So the Buddhist is very sensitive to this bell. Whatever bell, door bell, any bell, jingle bell, you know, immediately, you know, because of this association, it brings one back to oneself. No problem, nothing, yeah. If I'm sitting distracted and the doorbell is the bell that brings me back to myself, it's welcome, you know. We have to give permission to all the children in the neighborhood who ring and go away. It's wonderful. So the Om is like the bell. It has the power of that bell. I think it is a little more user-friendly, Om, because you don't need to buy a bell. You don't need to buy a cushion for the bell. And then you don't need to go remember to strike it. And then hear it and then, you know, get transformed by it. It's a little more, you know, eco. Yeah. In this time of letting go, it's very nice that the symbol to let go is also doesn't accumulate any other artifact. Om. Ding. Same thing. Yeah. And you know, somebody told me that that you can, I'm trying to remember exactly how they said, that you can buy this app. App? Yeah. You can buy an app for your phone, for your tablet, for your computer, which has that resonance of the Tibetan bell. The Tibetan bell app, which reminds you to come back to yourself when you're so completely gone into the computer. You have become one with the computer and you don't know how to extricate yourself. And then you can periodically or randomly assign it the job of bringing you back. And suddenly it will say, ding, 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 come back. And then it will, you know, and then you can also calibrate it for 5 to 10 to 15 minutes of meditation. So it will ring the bell during and before and after. So you see lots of gadgetry. And here, this Om is gadget-free. Om, that's it. Simple. All you need is a mouth. And also, very interesting, no one can mispronounce Om, even if you wanted to. You can't. You go to Alaska, ask them to say Om. Om only it will come. Go to China. Nothing they can pronounce. You ask them. Say Om, they will say Om. Go to France, another place where all the pronunciations are all, half of the words are silent and the other half are pronounced
as something else. In fact, we had a hard time when we hosted the French president in January in India for Republic Day, you know. And so the Indian news anchors were all calling him Mr. Holland, because that's how, you know, we would say H-O-L-L-A-N-D, Holland. What do you say? No, but it's something else. I don't even want to try pronouncing it. But it's exactly, but it's completely different, you know. And so the French, you know, they will not say the O is silent and the M is something. They will also, if you say Om, they will say Om back. And you go to this clicking culture. The Zulus have this clicking, you know, every, that language is something else. Oh my God. Before every word, click. After every word, click. Some words, two clicks after, one click before. And, you know, by the time you figure it out, you have gone into Maunam. But, total silence. Like Dakshinamurti, you will show the sign language. Because imagine teaching Vedanta there, you know? Click, click, tat, click, click, thvam, click, click, asi. And you have to say it so fast, and by the time you find out which clicks, because certain words beginning with consonants have more clicks than the words beginning with vowels. And certain times, and so to show certain moods, you have to have certain number of clicks. I know one woman from there, and when she talks, it is just, it's a work of art. You just have to look. Yeah, you just have to look and listen. So fast, quick, 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 click, 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 very fast. And so, you know, so all these, and even if you ask them to say Om, they may insert a click before and after, but it will still be Om. Click, Om, click, but Om is there. Om is there. What I'm saying is, it cannot be mispronounced. So in a sense, instead of just being the personal property of the people who study the Veda, it is revealed by the Veda as the universal nidhi, treasure for everyone, a message to let go. Om. And before we look at this mantra, we have to see this, you know, linguistically. We have already started to do that. And, you know, linguistically / phonetically, we have to see it grammatically, and we have to see it Vedically, scripturally, what this all means. And then the mantra will be very easy to understand. We'll take just a 2 minute, 5 minute break, just to stretch, etc. Come back. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate
Purnasya
Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Somewhat.
On Wednesday, I came to change the veshti. My desire was to put orange for this class.
Yeah.
But the orange veshti and the various jewelry, and and I knew that the maroon one you saw fit well,
yes.
It worked well.
Yes.
So I did that.
Wonderful.
It just coming in this morning, seeing the orange is like, you know,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah, it's wonderful. Please bring what I have kept in the drawer.
It's in the drawer account.
Yeah, yeah, bring both those things. I'll, you know.
The other sharing about that.
Yeah.
Normally I would have been here Wednesday later in the day.
Yeah.
But things happened and was So I came early and you were arriving.
Wonderful to see you.
I was like,
yeah, that's
not
a surprise. That's why I asked you, are you finishing or are you just coming? Because I know you come later, but you said you're already done. That was amazing. Yeah, so it's on the right hand side, draw two things. One is in a plastic box and the other is in a bag. Bring
those. They'll look different to me, sure.
Yeah. That would be nice for people to know. This has all the dresses. Some of them are pajamas, pants.
So it's really meant for evening, Jane. Okay.
This is a pair of pants with the frilly things, and the pants come with Velcro. It takes a little while to figure it out, but I'm sure you will. These are also pants.